This is Tatooine Sons, a pop culture podcast, the only fan podcast to name a canon Star Wars creature and to be endorsed by the writer and the director of The Last Jedi, Rian Johnson.
He is like my brother.
We have finally reached the final episode in our June series of discussing all of the major Star Wars animated series.
Boring conversation anyway.
And we're going to have a robust and in-depth discussion of The Bad Batch.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was good. It was fun.
I don't know how it ended.
We'll talk about that. This should be an interesting conversation because, as you just heard, one of us hasn't even finished watching the series. We'll share who, I think you know, and why next. This is Tatooine Sons.
It's true. All of it.
What is the name of the Porg on the Millennium Falcon?
Force is strong in my family.
What do you think his name is? It's a big moment.
I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
Maybe Turbis?
Do or do not. There is no try.
Turbis? Pablo, if you're listening to this live stream, that Porg's name is now Turbis. It's a good Star Wars name.
We're not done yet.
These guys recorded an awesome podcast called Tatooine Sons. Everybody was
A quiet place.
All right, so we've got a Quiet Place coming out. We've got Deadpool and Wolverine coming out.
We got Twisters coming out. Comes out before.
What is your most? I'll start with you, Sam, because Nathan will spend 20 minutes if we let him. but what's your most anticipated movie the rest of the summer that you can think of?
Probably Deadpool and Wolverine.
A great choice.
Deadpool and Wolverine.
Yeah.
You haven't seen Deadpool.
Not the first one.
I saw Deadpool 2.
I've seen Deadpool 2. Yeah.
Why are you excited about Deadpool and Wolverine?
Well, I'm curious to see its connection to the larger MCU.
Yeah.
That's what I'm curious
how they're bringing
to see.
It into the MCU.
Yeah,
is he really going to be MCU Jesus and reset it?
Right. I'm curious to see where they go with that.
What about you, Nate? What's your most anticipated movie?
I'm excited for Deadpool and Wolverine.
More than Quiet Place.
No, I'm just saying I'm excited. I'm very excited for Quiet Place.
Okay.
Very excited for the video game that was announced yesterday. That's going to be a ton of fun.
There's a Quiet Place video game?
It is, yes. It's coming out later this year. It's going to be a ton where you have to be silent and you have to survive.
On your headset?
I'm wondering if they're going to be having microphone capability too. But I think my most anticipated for the summer, which those weren't included, I'm really excited for Alien Romulus. I love the Alien series. Alien Isolation is probably one of the most fun times I've had playing a game, even though I got so frustrated so many times. It was really good. The original Alien is probably, if we're going for horror genre, it is my favorite horror movie.
What other horror movies have you seen?
It's accessible. I've seen all the Peele movies, which he just announced he's making another one coming out here pretty soon. And by pretty soon, I mean in 2 years. We don't even know what it's going to be about. But I'm very excited for Alien Romulus.
Are you out of your mind?
I think it's going to be really good and a lot of fun, and I'm hoping it's better than Aliens, which that's a hot take, but Aliens was not for me.
Good. No,
that's a, it is really interesting. You opinion. Can divide like sci-fi fandom into people that prefer Alien over Aliens,
and the people that prefer Alien over Aliens are the smart ones.
I think so too. Welcome to Tatooine Sons, a pop culture podcast. We believe that pop culture is the mythology of our generation, that there is a story, it is written on our souls, and that these myths speak to that story. And that is why we are talking about the most recent animated Star Wars series, The Bad Batch, which Sam still hasn't finished.
No!
Yeah,
I mean, it's not the most recent. It's the most recent big one.
A co-host of a Star Wars podcast.
It's pop culture now. We can't just say it's Star Wars.
It was originally Tatooine Sons of Star Wars.
But it was originally a YouTube channel, and we don't talk about that. So,
except you bring it up every episode.
I have to.
And then you're part of the group that, we named a canon Star Wars creature. And you've still not finished the most recent Star Wars animated series?
I barely made it through that last season, I think.
No, you were into it. You were like four episodes.
I think I like after the hiatus, I didn't watch any of those episodes. I think that's what happened.
You also haven't finished X-Men.
This is madness.
And you're part of a pop culture podcast.
Oh, I'm way
that's
behind
the one
on that
that's
one.
Really bad.
I know. Maybe you should have finished it, and we'll talk about that in our
talk about
yeah.
another episode sometime. But before we do that, we want to make sure that you subscribe to us on Substack. Make sure
Substack.
We have a mission for you.
You can do it through the traditional snail mail email thing, right? You know, like where you go to a computer or your phone and you get an email newsletter. And we're doing that stuff. But the app is where it's at. And
Amen.
That's where you can have real chats and conversations and you can follow. It's kind of like Twitter, but it's without the toxicity. It's not being run by a crazy billionaire. and we have a lot of fun. So we're trying to get to 100 by the end of this month. We've got like no time. Do it today, right now.
We got time.
Right this second. Pause this. Go download the app. Find Tatooine Sons, S-O-N-S. Subscribe, follow, and help us get to 100 on that.
Please.
I think that would be awesome. That would be amazing. We ask you to do so. So, but enough talking about what we're going to talk about. Let's talk about what we're talking about. Again, the most recent of the major Star Wars animated series. And just to make sure Nathan gets this in.
Not including like Tales of the Empire or anything, which we need to finish. So we hadn't finished that.
It was in the first episode.
I can't criticize Sam anymore.
Ha!
Tales of the Empire, we haven't
finished.
Do
you need to finish?
Roger, roger.
I do really want to finish that. We could have done that on Father's Day. I didn't think about that.
I forgot it existed.
Yeah, okay.
Which might be a problem.
We need to do that. No, people love it. It was a little controversial. The Mara Sophie stories were a little controversial.
Really? I feel like those would be the most popular.
But it's Star Wars, so why not? But anyway, it aired Bad Batch. That's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Right? We're not talking about Visions. We're not talking about.
I feel like Vision should be included in the major ones, but
it's not canon.
It's different.
It's so good.
It's good.
It's really so good.
But anyway, I don't even know what we're talking about.
We're talking about the Bad Batch.
Thank you. It aired from 2021 through 2024.
Jeez,
the cast is really easy. I mean,
90% of it.
It's like Dee Bradley Baker and Dee Bradley Baker and Dee Bradley Baker and Dee Bradley Baker and Dee Bradley Baker, and then Dee Bradley Baker a couple more times with that, and then Michelle Ang that played Omega, and Ming-Na Wen. I just decided to throw her in there because she was.
She was in a couple episodes.
And so it's playing Fennec Shand, and
you played Rampart.
Hey, it's me,
Rhea Perlman. Perlman played Sid. I don't know who played Rampart. I don't know who played any of the other characters because they don't really matter. So
that was a cheap move.
General thoughts on the series. I'll go to the one person in the room that other than me that's finished it. We'll start with them. Nate, what were your thoughts on the Bad Batch?
It was good. I mean, I know a lot of people really loved this series.
It's a very
loved this series. Very emotional. I mean, like I personally know people that really just enjoyed the series, and I love that for them. I thought it was good, but I mean. I feel like Clone Wars had more going for it. I liked the stories in Clone Wars a little bit better. And, of course, loved Rebels. Loved Rebels. And even to an extent, I felt like I could be more connected with the characters in Resistance than I could.
Why do you feel that? The Resistance characters.
Because we had no clue where, in any way, the Resistance would go.
It was airing alongside.
It was. And it was really cool to like go along with that. But with the Bad Batch, you know what happens. You know what happens. It goes to the original trilogy. And that was always something that Clone Wars struggled with in my eyes, too. Like, I know what happens to Anakin. And that's why I connected, of course, a lot of people connected the most with Ahsoka. Because you didn't know what was going to happen with her. And with Rebels, I mean, you didn't know where these people ended up. But you knew a couple of them were mentioned in Rogue One.
You all just wondered if they were all going
to
die.
Right. And so that was, you were able to get really connected with them, too. But when it comes to Bad Batch, I don't know if I... Like,
well, there was a moment people were concerned that the Bad Batch were all going to get killed.
Yeah, I was really concerned that Echo was going to die in some of those last episodes because he was the best character.
Spoiler alert for Sam.
Echo was certainly the best character in the series, but that's just probably because I had more connection with him. So,
Sam, you in your defense, you were finishing up your university degree.
Yeah, I had to graduate
in engineering. during the last weeks. Half of the final season specifically. So there's a reason why you haven't been able to finish this yet. But what are your thoughts on the Bad Batch as you've experienced it up to this point?
I mean, my overall impression for the series based on where I had left it was I just wasn't that interested in it. I just wasn't that interested. I don't know if I was... I think season two really turned me off pretty bad.
Why is that?
It was just, go do this thing for Sid and come back. Go do this thing for Sid and come back. There's not much to it.
It had a pretty amazing ending.
It had a great ending.
The Camino arc.
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, but again, I just think it's fundamentally, I didn't really care about the clones very much. You know, I mean, lots of people do. That's why the Clone Wars is so popular. You know, lots of people love Rex and Cody and all those characters.
I love Rex.
I do too. But some people really have an affinity for the clones, and I'm just like, they're fine. I was curious about the Bad Batch. The Bad Batch were one of the most interesting parts of that last season of the Clone Wars, and I was excited to see where they went with them. But I think overall, too, they were kind of underutilized in their own show, their own specialties. You know, I mean, part of like their first introduction in the Clone Wars, and we got to see this clip early at Celebration, was the scene when they're fighting all those droids, right, and they're showing off all their skill sets, and I was like, oh my gosh,
they're
this
all
is
playing
so
off
cool
of each other in that moment
in their own specific ways, right? I loved that, and I didn't feel like we started off with a bit of that, but it felt like that just kind of fell by the wayside, and they were just a group of clones towards the end, and you know, that's fine. But again, I didn't ever really care for the clones a ton, so I was at least, the one thing aspect about the characters that I was appreciative of kind of fell by the wayside, and so I wasn't interested. Plus, it felt like the story was kind of spinning its wheels a bit, too.
I feel like I the same way about the Bad Batch.
I got a bad feeling about this.
As a concept, as I struggle with some of Andor. Now, I think the execution
That's
on
fair.
Andor,
Light it up.
The story in Andor, the execution of it, like I said, is phenomenal. And I rank that second in my list of the live action series that have finished on Disney Plus. We haven't finished The Acolyte yet, so we don't know where to rank that yet. But second was Andor, and we've talked about that. But again, I struggle with Andor to some extent because for me, Star Wars should always involve the mythology, should always involve the Force, should always involve lightsabers.
Well, they had that.
We had some Asajj.
Had Asajj
in an episode.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
for like one, 5 seconds.
One episode, right? I was got really good there for a minute.
Yeah, you're like, ooh,
with that. So I feel that, I mean, it was just cool, right? But it could have been different characters in a different universe and the same story with it, except for they bring in Omega, and nobody's really talked about that. So let me get your guys' thoughts. Omega's the central character.
She is.
Of the Bad Batch series, which I don't believe when we came into this series, anticipating this series, that we had any idea that we were going to be going down that path.
No.
I think that they announced that we were going to have... I don't even know if they did.
I think it was a surprise.
In that first couple episodes with it. What are your thoughts on Omega as a character?
She's fine, I guess. I mean, maybe...
Do you think it's an age thing?
It could be. I think... I also don't know where her story ended up. So I don't know what they did with the character. I know she grew up.
We
kind
of don't either.
I know she grew up a bit, but I don't know anything more than that. It would be interesting to see what maybe an older Omega is like. But other than that, I just couldn't find any real interest in the character for me. Not that it's a bad character, but just nothing
you never
stuck
connected
out for
with
me.
The character. Mm-hmm. What about you, Nate?
Right. I think she was a fine character. I think up until some of the last parts of season three, I kind of found her slightly annoying.
Okay.
she was really? Very childish, I guess, in a certain way, which makes sense. She was a child in
even though
way.
She was older than the
even
bad
though
dad.
She yes yeah. But she had less life experience, I guess, is the way to say that. But she really found herself in the last arc of season three when she's trapped in the base with the other kids and trying to lead them to escape.
That's season four.
The last season.
You said season three.
No, I said the last arc.
Oh, of season three.
There was season four. Okay, yes, last arc of season four. Sorry. I really liked that. It was a great arc for her, and she found herself in that a lot. But outside of that, I just thought she was fine. Nothing really too special.
Mm-hmm. I felt like I always wanted the payoff of Omega and her being hunted by the the Empire by the Boba Fett stuff that happened in season three, mm-hmm. the Cad Bane stuff. I always wanted the payoff, and I never really felt like I got the payoff.
I agree with that. Mm-hmm.
So that's my biggest.
I don't like you either.
Not gripe necessarily. I mean, it was, I enjoyed the series, but I wasn't like dying when it ended, like it was with Rebels.
Right.
With that. And so, and again, I do think that, you know, people can take in the Star Wars that they like differently. We can appreciate the series, but maybe this wasn't, you know, the right sort series for us personally. But, you know, there's, it was definitely a surprise when they announced the series. I don't think nobody
Star kind of Wars expected
really
it.
Expected that that was going to happen. But I think it was also because we kind of had already had an experience with these characters in a completely different series. So I know you touched on this, Sam, a little bit ago, but we saw the first introduction we get to the Bad Batch in the Star Wars universe is the arc that they helped lead in season 7 of the Clone mm-hmm. Wars.
Ahsoka, surely you understand. This is a pivotal moment in the Clone Wars.
With it, what were your impressions of the Bad Batch coming out of that arc?
Oh, I was so excited. I mean, I think part of the reason is this is a really weird niche thing, but one of my favorite video games of all time is it's an old game, old relatively speaking, is TF2, Team Fortress 2.
Wow. Okay.
Again, real niche, kind of a throwback sort of thing. But the thing that makes that game so appealing, and it's still popular today, is it's a team-based shooter with characters that are so wildly different from each other, with absolutely crazy skill sets and personalities that none of them should ever be on the team together, but it works, and it's this fun, charming dynamic, right? And I saw that we got an aspect of that in Star Wars, right? And that made me really excited, because it's this group of completely different individuals, right, with completely different skill sets working together, right? And that, like I mentioned, that introduction scene was so cool when they're taking down the tanks, or like, you know, Wrecker is bringing, like, he takes the doors off the shuttle, yeah, and they're using them like really a mobile awesome. Shield, and you got Crosshair being the best out of the Bad Batch. Don't at me. I was still upset that they made him a bad guy. I don't know what happened to his character series. At the end. Okay, good. But he was so cool, and I was like, oh, great, we're going to get more of this. And that arc was great. So I left off that arc really liking those characters and loving the concept of the Bad Batch. Plus, I was curious to see if they're going to turn it into, what was it, Task Force 99 in that one comic book series where it was this group of stormtroopers that were all, there's a big one, there's a sharpshooter one. I was like, oh, are they going to go there with that? I guess they didn't.
They definitely didn't.
Which is kind of sad. I was, you know, there was the intrigue of that. Maybe they're going there with those characters. That also had me excited as well.
Yeah, I definitely liked the Clone Wars episodes. The second best arc in season 7, I think Siege of Mandalore will always
take. Oh yeah, you can't
take that. But it was that or Martez sisters, and the sisters were fine. But the Bad Batch really was awesome, and it was cool to see that. And you think, okay, we're gonna get a lot more of just what I thought was gonna be missions of the Bad Batch.
You're a rebel now.
Just what I was kind of hoping for, just some missions leading up, but. It didn't go that direction, and it was fun. Season 1 was fun. You got into that rhythm, and you thought they were going to be kind of leading to like where the clones themselves ended up, like what happened to the clones.
You are a clone and a soldier in the Republic Army.
And that didn't really happen towards the end. We didn't see that, and I mean, I know that at the end of, what was it, the Season 3 Kamino arc, definitely a lot of thoughts of like a clone resurgence and an insurrection against the new Empire, which would be awesome. That's what they were leading to with season 4, and it didn't go there, but seeing the beginnings of it in Clone Wars was really awesome, and I did enjoy it for sure.
Mm-hmm. You know, the series opens with what is, in my opinion, one of the best episodes of Star Wars animation. which is the opening episode of The Bad Batch, where you're seeing Order 66 being played out. You see Caleb Doom. You see the different dynamic among the Bad Batch, among Clone Force 99, the way that they're reacting with it. Start with you, Nate. Share your thoughts on that opening episode.
I loved seeing Caleb Doom. That was really awesome. It was a little jarring, I guess, a little frustrating for me, because I read the Kanan comic book series that detailed those exact moments, and they did not go down the same way at all. And I liked how the comic series handled that a lot. I really liked how they handled his story as an origin, but it didn't end up that way, so that was weird. But it was also still just awesome seeing Caleb Doom, and then seeing the differences between how Crosshair and the rest of the Bad Batch handle the Order 66. So the whole good soldiers follow orders thing, with Crosshair's chip working more. And it was a great episode. I remember watching it, having to watch it a couple times to pretty much appreciate what was going on, but I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I only remember fragments of that episode, really just what you've mentioned. But again, it was kind of this really bright start to things. I mean, we got to see a young Kanan, which is really...
Not that I expected to see him continue on, but no, it was a great way to anchor this story in the universe. And
Right. And we got to, it fleshed out a little bit of Rebels, barely, more as well. So that was cool. But yeah, I mean, I thought it was cool, like Nathan mentioned, to see what the characters thought about Order 66, because they were already always on the fringes of everything anyway. They very loosely followed orders when they were given to begin with. So let alone, imagine what happens when they're given an order to turn on their allies, right? So it was really cool to see how they handled that. I think we were all interested in seeing that going into the series as well.
Season 2 ends with the destruction of Kamino, and I think that's another highlight of this series, that seeing Rampart bombard Kamino, completely destroy it, the end of that answers a big question from the period between the prequel trilogy and the original trilogy, which why is there no longer a standing clone army? They resolve that question in season 2 specifically with that and the destruction of Kamino. Share your thoughts on that arc.
I again think it's cool to see the way the clones were treated post Order 66 and post the Empire taking over. We were always curious to see how that transition occurred. And I thought it was interesting to see the very first formations of the stormtroopers and to see how the clones were treated, like, I mean, let's just face it, garbage.
Is there a garbage chute?
Towards the end, when we had grown so close to these characters over, seven seasons with the Clone Wars and, a season and some change of the Bad Batch. So it was really curious to see their reasonings behind that too. And the destruction of Kamino, I didn't expect that. I didn't see that coming, but I like you mentioned, it did help kind of clear up some of that confusion going into later stories.
It did, and I thought that it was a really great arc. It was cool to see that answer in animation and see how it affected the Bad Batch themselves so much, and it continued on into season 3 to an extent. They kind of moved on pretty quickly in season 3 outside of that. But I really enjoyed the direction it was going in those first two seasons. And it felt like it took a bit of a 180 when it hit to season 3 about halfway through. And then season 4, it focused much more on the Bad Batch themselves rather than the larger story of the universe, which is not a problem. That helps a lot with kind of getting to know the characters more closely, I guess. But it was a great arc, and it was cool to see, and I enjoyed those aspects for sure.
Tell that to Kanja Club.
We get to season, again, the end of season 2, destruction of Kamino leads to the question of, they save La Musée, right? They bring her out, and we end up at Mount Tantus. And we start getting these connections. So we're going to Mount Tantus. That's connected to clones. That's connected to Heir to the Empire and Thrawn stuff. Meanwhile, we had season three of The Mandalorian, which brings out Project Necromancer, which brings out more cloning stuff that's going on. It feels like that's the direction that we're going. And we get that a little bit. We see that a little bit in season three, and they really start to go there in season four. But Nathan, you know, since you got to finish it out,
I might need a refresher on
the big culmination of season four was, oh, the clone program has been destroyed on Mount Tantus. Project Necromancer has been destroyed. That's the end of that. What did you think about the way that they closed out?
I think they closed out the Bad Batch's story very well, but they closed out what it could mean to the larger universe in a very unsatisfying way. It felt like we were at the end of that series, and we just felt a lot like, you know, what's the point?
I think that we said that a lot in this series.
We did.
What is the purpose of this
all series? Throughout the series?
I remember that. And what's the purpose? And then we thought we were getting it with Project Necromancer, and we thought we were getting it with, you know, Palpatine, like, and the cloning and the Snoke and tying into the Mando stuff and all of that, and we just didn't get that. And then even like the cool shadow troopers with the shadow assassin troopers or whatever those
we thought were gonna be
you know, past Cody clones or, yeah, Cody, yeah, yeah, or something like that.
They never resolved it at all.
It was there.
Wait, that whole shadow trooper thing? Yeah, explanation.
There was multiple of them, and they fought, and they just were defeated.
I was really thinking that was gonna be Cody or something.
Yeah, that was pretty much it. And so again, like
for something.
Yeah. Oh, I thought that's right. I thought it was gonna be Tech back. Dang it.
So that's what I mean. I think the Bad Batch's story, the, you know, Hunter, Tech, Wrecker, Crosshair, Omega, Echo, their story is not even Echo to an extent. He didn't really get a finished story, but the Bad Batch's story, it wrapped up with a nice little bow, and that was nice, and they're living happily ever after, and that's all good. But what it meant for Star Wars and the series itself and the franchise, it just felt empty. It didn't feel like we got much to it, which if you're watching it for the Bad Batch, that's great. But if you're watching it and you can't really feel connected to the Bad Batch, and you're wondering, why am I watching this show? It feels a bit of a letdown in those ways, but I think
this deal is getting worse all the time.
It was a good series for most of the aspects.
Yeah, I think that, you know, I brought it up earlier, and I joke about it all the time, that can something really be Star Wars without lightsabers in the Force and that kind of thing? We got very little of this in the Bad Batch, but there are some major Star Wars themes that were really present. And I think I want to end our conversation about that, where we talk about some of those important themes that are here in the Bad Batch. So we get, you know, the
ability to speak does not make you intelligent.
Sam, you said earlier from the very beginning, your favorite character in this was Crosshair. And so we get this scenario of Crosshair immediately staying with the Empire, turning against his brothers in this. Good soldiers follow orders, that kind of stuff. He ends up end of season two, into season three, coming to the realization that that's not the right decision for him. And he ends up being restored in season four to the Bad Batch and coming back to them. So there's these themes of redemption, of forgiveness within that. Talk a little bit about how you haven't seen the end here, but were you feeling like that was going to be something that happened? And you like the fact that they went there with Crosshair in this series?
This is not going to go the way you think.
I'm torn with it because I'm glad he's back, but it was a zero sum. Like, why did he leave it all in the first place? You know, I was upset that they made him leave because I wanted to see him with a team. That was part of the whole aspect I liked. I liked watching him work well with the other characters. Then they made him leave, and I'm like, okay. But I mean, I understand why they did it. It's so we could have gotten an inside perspective on what was happening in the Empire and how they were being treated and stuff. So I understand the utility of it. But I feel like at that point, if you're going to make him go there, I almost would have rather him stay bad. You know, because in the end, what was the point? I mean, yeah, it's a happy ending. It's, a, you know, you're wrapping it up nicely. And that's, I can appreciate that too. But it just felt weird. And I felt like the character was underutilized in his own strengths.
Nathan, you got to finish it out. You got to see the way it resolved. What did you feel about Crosshair's redemption and the forgiveness that takes place specifically between Hunter and Crosshair in season 4?
Yeah.
It was good. I enjoyed that arc. Loved the interactions and seeing them kind of all just all right with each other and living just fine, happy lives at the end was nice and all. It was good to see a happy ending, but it felt like they just really wanted to end this series and not have any ramifications for the larger, but set up something potential for the next series that we may be getting. But I liked the interactions a lot. That was my favorite part of season 4, was the interactions between Hunter and Crosshair and them having to work things out a lot, especially on that snow planet that they get stranded
on.
That was a great episode. Yeah. That was probably my favorite from season 4. And I really enjoyed a lot of those aspects. But overall, I would have loved to have seen Crosshair work with the Bad Batch more than we got. We didn't get Crosshair in his prime working with the Bad Batch, which was unfortunate.
Yeah.
I do like the fact that in contrast to some of the previous redemption arcs that we've seen in Star Wars, specifically Vader and Kylo Ren, Ben Solo, their stories end immediately after redemption.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In this story, we get to see
lies, deceptions.
Crosshair have to deal with the
lasting effects,
the impact, the ramifications of his betrayal and his turning away from his family and turning to evil, and then coming back, and how it's hard for Hunter to trust him. It's hard for Hunter to deal with it and that type of thing. And I think that's one of the beautiful things about Omega's character. Omega seems to be, while she is the youngest, and like you said, Nate, some of the early seasons, a couple seasons, she seemed to be a little childish at times.
Yeah.
She does end up being, when it comes to a lot of these scenarios, when it comes to the interpersonal stuff within the Bad Batch, she's the wiser of the group and is able to see things and bring her in. I love that about that character. Mm-hmm. We get that epilogue scene at the end of the series where you have, as the rebellion is fully in being engaged, a grown up Omega saying goodbye to Hunter and hopping into, it's an X-Wing, isn't it?
I think so.
Yeah, hopping into an X-Wing and going off to be a pilot in the rebellion. Did you like the way that they resolved her story?
Resolved is a loose term. It definitely feels like they're setting something up for a future series. I like to see where she would go very much, because that fits her character a lot. Just constantly not wanting to sit there while this war is going on and wanting to help. That fits Omega. That fits what we have known about Omega. So I liked what they did. Just want to see more of it, because it feels like they're definitely setting something up there.
There's a theory, I don't know if it's necessarily a rumor, Sam, but a theory that we now are going to see the next animated series be Omega as a pilot in the rebellion during the Galactic Civil War, which would then allow her, in sort of classic Star Wars animation form, we saw this a lot in Rebels, we saw this obviously in Resistance, we saw it a lot in The Bad Batch, interacting with other characters from that era. So do you like the idea of an animated series set during the Galactic Civil War that allows Omega as your main character to be your anchor, but also interacting potentially with a Luke, a Leia, a Han, maybe finding Boba Fett, some Vader stuff in that? What are your thoughts on that being the next potential animated series?
I fear nothing.
I mean, that's cool and all, but again, I don't have enough of a feeling towards a character to really be super interested in that. I mean, Ahsoka is one thing, because she had a lot more development and a lot more time to develop. I'll give her that in the Clone Wars. And we saw her in Rebels and things like that. So having a solo series for her, I know it was live action, but you know, you get my point. Fit better, I feel like. With Omega, I don't know. I don't know if there's enough about the character, enough special about the character to really warrant her being the main character for her own series. I don't know if that's enough draw. I almost wonder if maybe they would either need to set the series following a more popular character from that time period or a completely new character like they've done in previously with all the other series.
I would find it interesting if she's a pilot in the rebellion or during the Galactic Civil War and the underlying story is the Emperor hunting her down still because of her, what we learn about her and her ability, you know, the clone stuff that happens at the
end. Her blood is special.
Her ability to be cloned
is special. She's special in that way.
Part of that, I would like to see that connect to some connective tissue.
That
would bring that in. You know, we usually have an announcement about Star Wars Animation, the next series, sort of really close to when the previous series ends. We haven't gotten anything right now, so we're just going to have to kind of hold back and wait and see what comes.
Anything else?
All right, that's going to do it for this week. If you're coming to the series or coming to our show, the series.
Talk my way out of
I'm still stuck on series. If you're coming to the podcast, we thank you so much for being a part of this and jumping in. We hope you know that we've got multiple episodes every single week, Mondays. Whatever we're geeking out about that week, we're talking about that on Monday. So that's kind of our current get it out of our heads conversation show. Wednesdays, we talk pretty much comic books and comic book centric things. And so, you know, it'll start off with weekly releases and what we're reading right now. And then we'll end up taking a conversation about a comic book and it ends up talking MCU and DCU and all this crazy stuff that goes on that. So tune in on that.
This is madness.
And then Fridays is our series next month because this is the last Friday of June. Next month we're gonna have a new series. Since we did a couple weeks ago, we did our rewatch on Father's Day of the sequel trilogy. I thought,
I have an idea.
Let's revisit the sequel trilogy. So we're gonna have a revisiting The Force Awakens, revisiting The Last Jedi, the greatest Star Wars movie of all time, revisiting The Rise of Skywalker, and then
I'm from the Resistance,
considering and speculating responsibly
the future of
about Rey. The future of Rey is the last episode. So that's what we're going to do in the series in July. So we hope you will tune in. Follow us on Substack.
Yes.
Get the app. Subscribe.
Get us to 100.
Engage. Get us to 100. I think that's going to do it for this week. Anything else you guys want to say?
May the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you always.
This party's over.
I like that Wookiee.
Don't get technical with me.
Join, please.